make known your presence now. Be glorified, oh God, in the midst of the congregation. Be glorified, oh God, make known your presence now. Be magnified, oh God, in the midst of the congregation. We sing praise. We sing praise. Praises to the name of Jesus. Praises to the Lord. Praises to the name of Jesus. Be magnified, O God. Praises to the name of Jesus. Praises to the Lord. Praises to the name of Jesus. Be magnified, O God, in the midst of the congregation. Make known your presence now, in the midst of the congregation. Be glorified, standing here in the midst of your church. Let every eye now see, standing here in the midst of the church, is the glory and the majesty. Jesus, Jesus, name by which I am redeemed, redeemed, redeemed. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by Jesus.
Hallelujah.
In the midst of the congregation, be glorified, oh God. Make known your presence now.
Be magnified.
Be magnified. Be highly exalted, Lord.
Hallelujah. I'm rehearsing for lead singer in heaven. Lead worshiper. Hallelujah. Or at least right in the number of those who are. Hallelujah. Actually, he's here, whether you recognize him or not. You know, Hagar thought she was going to die and thought Ishmael was going to die. And so she put him underneath a shrub, a bush out there in the wilderness. And as she was sent out away from the house of Abraham, and the scripture says that she put him far away from her, about the distance of a bow shot. Maybe 300 yards or so at most. And because she didn't want to see him die. And what she had forgot is, first and foremost, is that she forgot that the Lord was the one who saw her or sees her. She had actually had that revelation. He is the Lord, or he is God who sees me. She forgot that one when she was put out of, when she ran away from Sarah. Previously, before Ishmael was born, I have him being put out, and she felt just totally abandoned. She totally rejected. She was, but not abandoned of the Lord, and not rejected of the Lord, because there was a covenant there. There was a covenant just because he was the seed of Abraham. Thinking there was a covenant there, even though he didn't really even want to walk with God, there was no indication that there was a covenant there. And so the Lord opened up her eyes, that she could see a well of water, a spring of water. Now, it wasn't there. It wasn't something natural. It was totally spiritual. Because if it was in the natural, she would have already seen it. Her eyes had to be open to see. Today, God wants to open your eyes. I'm going to take the extremes because this is what God always does. Don't leave. Don't leave, please. Just stay right with me, everybody. Just stay right with me. God wants to do something in your life. Father wants to do something in your life, dear people. You're going to have to come to a place of bowing before Him and reverencing Him and making Him as sacred as He is. And forgetting about everything else. It's going to have to become subordinate to who He is or you'll never get to see. Father wants to open your eyes so that you can see. You know, we're so distracted with all of our other stuff, we don't have time to see. The one thing with Hagar, she is brought to the end of herself. She is about to die. It was all over. You can understand that there is an intense cry when you're dying. God said, I heard the voice of the lad. I heard the voice of the young man. The angel comes to Hagar and says, God heard the voice of the young man. He heard the cry of the young man. And He opened up her eyes that she might see the provision of Almighty God. I'm going to tell you, what we don't understand is that Christ Jesus stands in the midst of His congregation. We've turned so much into religion. We've turned it so much into church. We've turned it so much into merchandising and commercializing that we don't really get it. It's been all messed up from birth. We've had been taught the wrong kind of culture. We've been taught the wrong kind of positioning, as it were, ourselves and the process by which we come into the Lord. I'm going to tell you, I pray God in Jesus' name that some people in this place will have their eyes open. You'll be beginning to see the sacredness and the beauty of Jesus. And I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. You'll become a champion for the kingdom of God to go everywhere and destroy the power of religion that is preventing men from coming in. I'm going to tell you right now, everything about your life, the way you talk, your behavior, it won't be about pleasing people. It'll be about pleasing God. Because you'll be earnest. You know, I'm just going to go ahead and talk a little bit. Here, minister a little bit. The reality of it is, people want to just make the things of the kingdom of God flippant. And then I was like, oh, well, we all need to be joking around because God likes humor. And come on, man. That's a totally different issue. This is something about a matter of life and death. Jesus is a matter about life and death. For me, He's a matter about life and death. He was a means by which I could step out of death into life. He's a man. And not only that is He the issue of life and death, but He is so sacred. Yeah. No. He's so sacred. I mean, no. He's so sacred. He's so sacred. He's the most captivating, the most amazing, the most awe. I mean, I have been blessed having been able to study so many things and be involved in so many different things that really have to do with the fundamentals of the way that life functions. I remember the first time I looked at an embryo underneath the microscope and began to deal with the whole issues in embryology of how I could take be a part of watching a single cell develop into something that's so amazing and so complicated and so intricate. And you're not sitting here laughing. I'm starting to tell you, not laughing. You're like, oh, wow. You know, the majesty of a sunset, the majesty of something in creation that is shockingly beautiful. I mean, when I first stood in front of Victoria Falls, I wasn't laughing. You know what I'm saying? Right? I'm like, wow, this is amazing. You're not laughing. You're not joking around. You're not flippant about things. Jesus, just come sit down with you. We'll help you. We'll break that yoke. Mata sebere te kanaya. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, people, I just want you to know, we welcome you here. We're glad that you're here, but we're going to talk to you about Jesus. We're not going to give you Christian philosophy. This is not going to be the principles of Christian ideology. We're going to minister to you the Word of God. We're going to try with everything that we know in Christ Jesus, everything that we've received in the Holy Ghost, to bring you to a place where you become so desperate for God, so hungry, so thirsty, so needy of this relationship, that you allow the Spirit of the Lord to come open your eyes so that you can see the fountain of living water right there in front of you and take a drink and out of that. When you see him and you take a drink, a lot of people say, they come try to take a drink of the living water, and that's just religious. It's just an idea, it's a concept. Somebody said, here, try this, you know, and it's like, well, okay, you know, I'll do whatever. But the reality of it is this fountain of living water is right here. And He's saying, come take a drink. In Jesus' name. He's saying, come take a drink. But you got to see the fountain.
you got to take a drink of something. And this is not pretend tea time with the four-year-old. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to take a little kid and then a little sip here, dad or papa or whoever. I've got some tea and we've got some biscottis here, right? And there's nothing on the plate and there's nothing in the cup, but you guys are going to go ahead because you in the thing, right? You there in the pretend, right? We're going to act like there's something in there and we're going to be sweet to one another. Too much churches like that. I'm just sorry for you. I'm sorry to disrupt your sense of comfort. I'm telling you, church is about Jesus. It's about Him being revealed.
Yes.
The only way the church could ever be what God wanted it to be to glorify His Son was the Holy Ghost and fire had to be poured out upon the church. That was the only way possible for the church to be the glory of the only begotten Son of the Father in the midst of the earth. There had to be the glory of heaven come and fill the place. I was so blessed this morning, walking, heard Ruth Anna singing in the spirit. And then, you know, I love that because that's what God wants. He wants the flow of the Holy Ghost to produce whatever prayer you pray. He wants the flow of the Holy Ghost to produce whatever song you sing. He wants the flow of the Holy Ghost to produce whatever life you live. He wants the flow of the Holy Ghost to produce every thought you think. Come on. He wants the flow of the Holy Ghost to produce every deed of your heart. Of your life and of your action. People just want to say, oh, no, 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 no. Oh, I'm a Christian, you know, because I was whatever. My goodness, come on. Christ Jesus died at Calvary's cross to bear our sins away. I want to talk to you about Jesus. I want to talk to you about the one whom the church is supposed to be the full revelation and manifestation of. And as soon as we break past all of the stuff that hinders, the world's going to see a glory of the only begotten Son of the Father standing in the midst of you and me, upon our face, in our lives, in our congregation. He's going to be heard seeing. I'm always looking for Jesus walking up the aisle in the midst of the congregation, because the scripture says He stands in the midst of the congregation and He sings praises. No, there's many times when I'm in prayer, I can almost touch Him. In worship, many times He becomes almost visible to me. So once again, walking in the church, hearing that flow of the Holy Ghost, and then there's the song is born. The song of the Spirit is born. The song of the Spirit is born. What God the Holy Ghost wants to do to glorify Jesus, how He wants to glorify Jesus. Not how somebody who sat in a living room somewhere and wrote a song for maybe some ulterior motives, and then everybody puts it up on an acetate and sings it, or writes it in a book and open up your hymn. And there's some great hymns and there's some great songs that were written by the anointing of the Holy Ghost in the midst of the church. Amen. But I'm going to tell you right now, reality of it is, there's a lot that isn't. And I don't even want to talk about the statistics of it. I just wanted to say, look, people, there's something. God has something far more for you. Oh, manasekiyapreté. I pray in Jesus' name you won't be so busy. You know, Jesus, the word, the name means Jesus. It was first, that word was first used, that name was first used of Joshua, or who we would say in the Hebrew language, Yehoshua, who's called the son of Nun, the servant of Moses, who led Israel into their rest and into their inheritance. That's what he did. It's the first time the name was ever used. And then, of course, it was also used of Joshua the priest, the son of Josedek and Zechariah. But that name was only fully fulfilled and realized in the person of Jesus, who was born in Bethlehem of Judea. I mean, I'm telling you right now, I was so blessed by the authority of Jake the other night, man. Jake alias Simeon. Or Simeon alias Jake. He walks out with his beard, his gray beard on, you know. Simeon, the Lord showed it, revealed to him he would not die till he seen the Lord's salvation. Literally, he used, that's the phrase, Yehovah's salvation. Yehovah is the name that you hear people say, Jehovah, which is closer than the Yahweh thing, because the Yahweh doesn't even fit phonetically in any way, it doesn't fit. But Yehovah's salvation, the Lord's salvation. Ma, I would not die until I saw the Lord's salvation. He's the one who's come to save us from our sins. Matthew chapter 1 and verse 21, you shall call him Yehoshua, or as we say in the Greek, Jesus, or as we say in the English, Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. You don't know Jesus till you save from your sin. People got all these ideas and concepts and they think that there's many roads that lead unto God because they're humanists. That's the extreme humanism. And then you've got so much of a humanistic doctrine, which is espoused by an angel of darkness. He's a principality. He has power and authority in the realms of the demonic, just like Gabriel and Michael has power and authority in the realms of the kingdom of God that belongs to that realm, which Father dominates and rules and reigns over. This angel of humanism integrates all of these things about God with, as much as he can, with his doctrines of humanism, making everybody feel like that they're okay, that they're all right, and there's no jeopardy, and there's no sense of urgency. There's no ability to read the Word of God. Your eyes are blinded. Deception has no reason to it, no logic. I've been with very smart people showing them the Word of God, and they can't see it. I'm saying, well, look, and all they want to do is talk about some isolated, out of context verse of scripture that supports, you know, their Neoplatonism that they call Christianity. Oh man, I tell you right now, I'm a mess. I understand that. When it comes to most people, I'm a mess because all my basically what I do is I love to parse things. I like to say, okay, well, is that something that God said in his word, or is that something that was said by Augustine, or was that something that was said worse by Plato or Socrates or Aristotle? Because let me show you. Let's go. Let's turn the pages. I read too much. Let's look at what Aristotle said. Doesn't that sound so much like what that said, right? Look at that. Now, let's see if we can find a comparison in the scripture. Aristotle, what you believe? You're a disciple of Aristotle, but you say you're a Christian. And you say you got that from the Word. No, you didn't get that from the Word. You get that from the Word. Jesus, you should call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. Here, I want you to open your Bibles real quickly. I'll just show you a couple verses of scripture. Look at Galatians chapter 1, verse 4. I want you to look at Galatians chapter 1, verse 4. I want to talk about Yehoshua. Yehoshua. His name was abbreviated to Yeshua. Yeshua is an Aramaic derivation. Listen to me. You need to hear this. You need to hear this on web, YouTube. Actually, Yeshua is an Aramaic derivation espoused by Talmudic Jews to remove all sense of the Yahwistic name from him. Any revelation of the Father. When you say Yeshua, you've removed Yahweh's name. What they say is what many would call Yahweh, which we call Yehovah, which we just say Lord in the Old Testament. You just see Lord. Every time you see Lord, usually it's a translation of Yehovah. So the Jews who were just, you know, who were, that were Talmudic Jews, who wanted to be somewhat derogatory towards Jesus and insulted Jesus, actually reduced his name to Yeshua, which many people went around saying, oh, well, we're supposed to praise him in the original tongue, Yeshua. Well, that's Aramaic to start with. And so, furthermore, you ought to go look at how it was reduced to Yeshua. It was to remove any thought of a Yahwistic, what we call the theophonic recognition. And I don't use big words on you. I'm just trying to help you understand that these are the things that we talk about in the school of theology, if you would, the study about the Word of God and what people believe, okay? And then they further made it even worse from Yeshua to Yesu. And so that his name sounded with no ring of God the Father. They want to remove the Father's name from him. Because when you say Yehoshua or when you say Jesus, you're saying literally that he is Yehovah, Almighty God, the Father, who was revealed in the Old Testament over and over again, the Almighty, whom Jesus, the eternal Word, was hid in the bosom of the Father until the day the Father wanted to show, here he is, here is the Savior, here is the salvation. He was the eternal Word, and he came as the Word, the Logos, which means God defined, God revealed, God declared, God proclaimed. He came and showed the Father. He says to Philip, have you seen me? Then you see the Father. He came in the fullness of God. He came in the fullness of the power of God to display to us what Father intended when he made Adam and what the new creation looks like. We want to have all these idealistic definitions of the new creation, of the new man. They want to have all these idealistic concepts of what it means to be born again, to be wholly acceptable to God. And all the time, they're just absolutely sidestepping Jesus, who is the revelation of the Father, who shows to us exactly what Father created and what he intended to have when he shaped Adam in his own image and his own likeness. And so Paul says radically in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 24, he said, we've been recreated. God's done it all over again. This time, meaning just breathed into us the breath of life, which is an awesome thing. Every man alive today, the breath that they breathe originated from the Father's own breath, according to the scripture. I'm not an allegorical type of a person. I don't believe in similes of God. I don't believe in all these mythical things that people want to make the Word of God to be. It's just literal. Over and again, God has proven that His Word is literal. And what He said, He is literally going to do. Nicodemus says, how can a man enter a second time into his mother's womb? God says, I got a spiritual one for you. It's going to be as literal. It's going to be as real, but it's in the realm of the unseen. The power of the Holy Ghost overshadowed Mary. The power of the Most High came upon her, and the glory of God overshadowed her, and that which was born inside of her was born out of the Holy Ghost. Describing just how you and I would also be born in the same kind of miraculous new birth. Hallelujah. Come on, man. Father wants to open your eyes and so that your eyes can be open and you can see the well of life, the provision of life. It's there. It's totally hidden from the natural. But it's there. It's there. All God has to do is open your eyes. All you got to do is be willing to let Him. Because, see, it's so sacred. See, all this is free. Father gives it fully and liberally and without reservation, but it's still nonetheless as sacred as it's always been, if not more sacred. It's more sacred because the power of the Holy Ghost has been poured out like never before. The Holy Ghost shall come. The Holy Ghost will flow out of you. This spake he of the Holy Ghost, which was not yet given to man, for he had not yet been glorified. Come on, I want you to get out of yourself and get into Jesus. I want you to get out of your stuff. You got to think different. You don't think right. Somebody said, I don't think right. So you the one going to come tell me how to think? No, I'm going to point to you how to think. These are the thoughts of God. And I'm going to tell you, I'm doing everything I know to do to jerk people out of the realm of what they have exalted as so right, their own thoughts. What they perceive to be. I'm going to tell you right now, your perception is colored by your ideology, which you were born into and shaped in by nothing like anything that's ever been seen before. It's not just cultural shaping. It's now an academic, it's an institution. It goes beyond what just the parents would model and the relatives around you in a community would model. It's something that you are taught 8 hours a day. It's drilled into you. They strip you of all ego and shape you in their own image. That right there is the premise of all education. You might not understand what I just said. But you just go read the tape, put on slow, stop, pause, and think, and look, Google it. And you're going to find all kinds of support. I'm going to tell you right now. Somebody said, you said Jesus was born in 4 BC, before 4 BC. Yeah, well, you know what? He was. He was born in the time of Herod. Herod died in 4 BC. Google it. And then it'll lead you to the library, and you'll discover that what I said was true. I'm not just spouting these things out just off the top of my head, man. We put our heart and our life and our soul and our being into those things which belong to the kingdom of God. Why? Because we're so earnest to see the reality of His truth established in God's people. They've been brainwashed with the wrong stuff. They've been taught by a culture, a wrong process of approach. They're constantly studying the ark and dying, don't know it. Trampling all over the anointing and wondering why God can't move. Doing it man's way, speaking man's thoughts. Man, if somebody gets just a little bit more of an anointing or a manifest presence of Jesus to someone else, we think we're in full-blown revival. Yet we all ought to be seeing the Word of God calling us to the life and ministry of Jesus. The beauty of that which He did. These works, He speaks to any single one. These works, I mean, it's not some kind of ascetic lifestyle. It's simply coming into a relationship to where the power and the authority and the glory of God rest upon you. You can wake up in the morning in your pajamas and multiply the loaves and the fishes. You can wake up in the morning with your hair all messed up and bad breath and raise the dead. Not even hardly thinking yet. Because it's just, this glory is on you. This relationship is in you. And people look at this and they say, well, why is it happening? It didn't happen because we're not stepping into the sacred like God has purposed us to. We're not willing to forsake our thoughts. We're not willing to forsake our ways. They're too important to us. Jesus came to deliver us from our sins. His name shall be called Jesus, for He shall deliver His people from their sins. Matthew chapter 1, verse 21. I believe it's John 1, 29, where John the Baptist said, "Behold, behold God's Lamb." That day that Father had Abraham in this examination, take the son that he loved and take him up to us to the hill that he would show him, which ended up being Moriah, where Christ Jesus himself was crucified. Isaac says to him, "Father, behold the wood and the fire and the knife. Where is the lamb for the offering?" He says to him, he said, "God will provide for himself a lamb." And so men waited from that day, approximately 1670 years. And then a prophet, a radical prophet that Josiah represented the other day, in the play. I mean, that was pretty amazing. I want to see him come into a great anointing, step out and do it. But he did it, and he did it. He did it. I want to train him in an anointing, not a show. I want to train him in an anointing, not a show. I want to train him in being just yielded to God so now he can represent heaven to humanity rather than just pleasing of men, tickling of the ears, and sensations of human interest. Abraham said, God will provide himself a lamb. John the Baptist shows up 1,670 years later, says, "Behold the lamb. Behold God's lamb." It's literally how it says, "Behold God's lamb. Who will take away the sin of the world." You listen to me. Who will take away the sin of the world. You listen to me. Who take away the sin of the world. Hallelujah. I've been washed in the blood. I had a death sentence passed upon me of which I could do nothing about. I was ensnared by the powers of darkness under their tyranny, under their reign, slaves to sin, enslaved to their women and wishes. Jesus Christ came and rescued me with his redeeming blood, washed me, cleansed me, totally made me righteous and holy without any works of righteousness which I've done, but by a free gift. And then we spend all this time trying to wake up to the reality of how wonderful, how beautiful, how sacred, how holy it is. And a religion comes along and tells us, "Oh, come on, you can sin more or less every day because after all you whatever," and then makes it all just a show, a sideshow, and Jesus is a circus freak. Now listen, I'm talking about the Spirit of the Lord, whether you realize it or not. Somebody said you're spitting everywhere. It's the same morning, Shamu. If you sit on the front row, you're gonna get wet. I'm Spitzbergen. Okay. Hallelujah. Yeah, and I'm done. I hope you get as stirred up about it as I am. Yes. I'm done with Jesus being a sideshow and a circus. Come on now. A bunch of religious people got all these crazy ideas and notions, and there's no power or truth or revelation of the person of Almighty God. I'm done with it. Long ago, and that's why I am who I am. The Spirit of the Lord has stirred me up. The zeal of the Lord has consumed my inner being. Somebody said, "Oh, Mark, something really happened to you, man. Oh, wow, you've really been renewed in the spirit of your mind." Give me a break, man. I was born again and fell in love with Jesus Christ and let the Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost, lead me and guide me. And I'm filled up with his word. And I love his word and I speak his word. Yeah. And that's what you call a renewed mind. Give me a break. Because I've watched people all my life talking about, "Oh, laying aside the weight and the sin." They never done nothing, man. Because it's not by, they're not seeking God by due process. They're still saying the same thing that they were saying 40 years ago. Because the only way you move forward in God is by the miracle of his word. It's a miracle of his word. His word produces a miracle in those who will agree with him and begin to speak out of their mouth what God says and agree with what Father has declared and now move with him and call what he has done completed. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. He took my sins away. He became for me the sin offering. Somebody said, "Well, he became," the scripture says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21, he became the sin. You didn't understand. You need to go read a little bit more. I can't help it. It was mistranslated. He became the sin offering. The chatat, or the Hebrew chatat, it's chatat literally means sin, but in the application of all Levitical priestly sacrificial system, it always means sin offering. Hallelujah. He became the sin offering for you and me that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. And I'm not going to let what he did at the cross of Calvary, his rejection, his shame, his brutal beating, all that he went through, be in vain for my life. I mean, if he can do all that for me, I can be right. If he can be a sin offering for me, I can be righteousness for him. Yes. Man believes in his heart unto righteousness. People walk around, we sinners. We're going to sin more or less every day, because they go and try to isolate one verse of scripture that can be translated so many different ways, where Paul says, referring to his state that he was in, concerning how God delivered him, being a blasphemer and an injurious person, the one who was there and persecuted the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, Jesus died to save sinners, of who I am first a sinner. And now he goes on, but you need to go on and say, he also says, of whom Christ is first revealed in me. Two verses later, I don't want to go that far. I don't want to isolate that verse of scripture from all the other verses of scripture and say, see, we're sinners more or less every day. And they want to say, there's no good thing that is in me. My goodness, you need to be born again so Christ Jesus had come on the inside of you. Then you have a real good thing. And furthermore, the Holy Ghost come on inside of you, you have a really double good thing. And then the Father of God come make us dwell on the inside of you, and you can have a really big good thing. And then the rivers of God's divine power and majesty and glory will flow out of you. And you're going to tell me you don't have any good thing in you. You are wrong. It's the wrong doctrine. It's the wrong belief. I wanted to say faith, but there's only one faith. It's a misused word. People talk about the Muslim faith, the Buddhist faith, the Hindu faith. There's no faith outside of God. And it belongs and was summarized in the name Jesus. No faith outside of Jesus. Faith is not something, it's not a belief system. Faith is a power of God unto salvation. Hallelujah. I want to see people raised up who will preach the word of God, speak the word of God, give place to that which Father is doing, honor the things of the Father, hold them sacred, walk in the sacredness of it, hunger and thirst after righteousness for his name's sake. Amen. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and recognize that he will lead us in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. People accuse me all the time of us hybridizing verses of scripture. That's fine. I do that on purpose. I know the separation of them. I just have got a lot of stuff to say, so I just take those that are in common, bring them together in one phrase, and hope you get it. Because my interest is in any way itching your ears, pleasing, agreeing with your doctrinal bias. My interest is declaring the word of God unto salvation. That's it. My interest is in breaking off the stinking yoke of religion, because it smells. My interest is helping you see how ugly you are in comparison to Jesus, so you'll deny yourself and let Christ Jesus live. Yeah. Hallelujah. I might pull out one of the most radical verses of scripture in the Bible and preach on it. I bear in my body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that Christ may be manifest in me. Nobody understands that verse of scripture now. Nobody understands 2 Corinthians 4:10. It's a forgotten reality and doctrine. The bearing in his body, the dying of the Lord Jesus. What on earth does that mean? Yeah, exactly. Essential to the covenant. Essential to the walk. We want to live our own life and think that we're on our way to heaven. All dogs don't go to heaven. In fact, no dogs go to heaven. And Father has come to change you from a dog into a lamb. Praise God. Amen. And make you of a different kind, of another kind, not to live as a mere human existence. See what happens? It's just like Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, forgive me. Here you got all these people that have been born of the Spirit. They've been born of the Lord Jesus Christ. They have names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And then they get distracted and they want to get off into religious things and start in. And you know, you're in religion as soon as you're into strife. As soon as you hear people talking bad about other people, you in religion. Huh? People arguing, you know, and they're arguing about the moving of the Holy Ghost. You know, here's a good one. Here's a good one I heard the other day. Someone was saying, yeah, this guy was just really raking me over the coals. It was a bomb, big, gigantic fight. He's talking about Wesley's doctrine of sinless perfection. I said, isn't that something? You guys sitting around arguing under the influence of a demon spirit of strife talking about sinless perfection. You know, that's about it. Because there's just no reasoning. Here we go, argue, enter into a spirit of strife about sin. Give me a break. This is humanity. This is the way the world looks on us. Is there ain't nothing there. Let's go look someplace else. Huh? It's because we look like a grapevine in the wintertime. There's nothing beautiful about a grape. Have you ever passed by a vineyard in the wintertime? Have you ever passed by a vineyard in the wintertime? There's no green leaves. It doesn't look like it'd ever live again. It doesn't look like it could ever live. It's ugly. It looks like somebody done cursed that place. Are you listening to me? Huh? It's an entirely different story when you're there right about harvest time. You got all those grapes, and my goodness, and sometimes you can develop those grapes to where the clusters can be as much as 2 foot long and over a foot in diameter. Come on, people. The world needs to see the church of the Lord Jesus Christ radiating with the glory of his person. And you're going to have to quit being who you are. And start being who he created you to be. Start being who he says you are. Amen. Just start doing it.
Amen.
Just start agreeing with it. Somebody says, no, it's too far from me. It's beyond me. No, the word of God is there in your mouth and in your heart that you may do it. That you may do it. Do it.
Amen.
Do what God said. Be what God declared you are.
Amen.
I'll tell you right now, you better purify yourself, even as he's pure. He's about ready to come. You better listen to me. That's the way John said it. If I just did, one day I gave myself to just memorizing all the epistles. I memorized the epistles of John to start with. And I started thinking, if I preach like John, if I just did nothing but just, because I can quote the epistles of John. If I did nothing but just preach like John and I practice this too, because I would just take and write things and I would not even, I'd make sure that I edited out any word that was my word. So it was all just taking and weaving together the scriptures. Okay, so it was all God's word. Practice it sometime, it'll do you good. To tell the whole gospel story and don't use any of your words, huh? Declare the will of the Father and don't use any of your words. Polycarp did so, and we're so thankful that Polycarp did it. Polycarp was the last guy alive at a period of time that knew John, John the Apostle. He basically was a servant to John the Apostle. And at Philippi, they said, please tell us, because he was continued to be a traveling minister. He said, please give us, he was towards the end of his life, just before they martyred him, just before they killed him. He said, please tell us something about your personal experience with John. And what he did was he sat down and he wrote an epistle to the Philippians. You can go and get it on Google, Polycarp's Epistle to the Philippians. And in that, he just told the gospel story and the will of the Father using scriptures from Matthew to Revelation. And we're so thankful for it from the perspective of doing what we call lore criticism or redaction criticism, because we are able to see a justification for many verses of scripture that otherwise we wouldn't really know for sure or have the evidence or the proof to say, no, that's actually what John wrote. Mm-hmm. Listen to what Polycarp said. Just imagine the witness and the testimony and the value that you bring, the evidence, the witness that you bring when you quit walking by your spirit and walk in his spirit. Hallelujah. When you quit speaking your words and you start speaking his words. You know, that's what Isaiah said. Isaiah said, if you'll quit speaking your own words, if you'll quit doing your own will, if you'll quit walking it out like you think it should be done, he said, then I will feed you with the heritage of Jacob, and I shall cause you to walk upon your high places. Come on, people. God's word never changes. It never fails. Father's just talking to us. He's wanting to bring us into a place of a realm called sacred. We live in a realm called profane. The majority of people live in a realm called profane. They all integrated with the world. They all integrated with humanism and feminism, which are two of the greatest expressions of rebellion against God that exists right now. Humanism pervades almost every dimension of human thought today. And it has found a place, been exalted, and as it were, set in a high place in the midst of the church. Paul says, it, back to my story, God's story, the 1 Corinthians chapter 3. He looks at those who have been totally set free, names written in the Lamb's Book of Life, washed from their sins, born again. And he says, look at you guys. You in strife. You saying that you have this group and you have that group and you belong over here and you guys are the Holy Ghost shakers and you guys are the Holy Ghost bowers and you guys are the Holy Ghost shouters and you all this other stuff. He said, you are acting as mere men. You walk as mere men. You forget all about who's the one who's supposed to be being seen. Who's the one who's supposed to be being glorified? To see Jesus in the midst of his church is going to demand you and I have a huge change in the way that we approach to him. A huge change in how sacred he is. You show me a person who has a revelation of the sacredness of Jesus, and I'll show you a person who's intimate with him. You show me a person who honors him, who's captivated by him, I'll show you a person who's functioning and flowing in a depth of relationship that the door is open for everybody to have. We're so distracted with all these other things. The Lord says, listen, that's why I'm telling you, above everything else, what's first and foremost that you got to understand is that you've got to go after the reality of the kingdom of God, the kingdom now. See, the kingdom of God is now. It's right now. It's the kingdom of God is coming, but the kingdom of God is right now as well. It's right now. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. See, the kingdom of God is now. Hallelujah. Romans 14, 17. For those of you who don't know that verse of scripture, kingdom of God is not, you know, the food that you're eating, your ritual and your form, but it's righteousness. It's a display of righteousness through your life, which can only happen by the Holy Ghost because it's a fruit of the Spirit. Hallelujah. There's more than 9 fruits of the Spirit. You listen to me. I can give you over 26, maybe 27, depending on how you separate them out. Come on. And we don't have to try to, you know, 1, 2, 3. It's giving ourselves over to the character of the divine nature that has allowed us to do what? Escape sin. Escape the corruption that is in the world through lust. To escape all the demonic influence. Be kept by the power of God. Satan can't touch you. The greater one lives on the inside of you. Not if you believe that there is no good thing in you. You got to believe that the greater one lives on the inside of you. If you believe that there's no good thing in you, the greater one ain't in you then. And you totally misunderstood Romans chapter 7. But it could have gotten all straightened out if you just read Romans chapter 6 a little bit better and read Romans chapter 8 just a little bit better and said, wait a minute, what's this here sandwiched in between? Huh? And you had understood that Paul was writing what we call the historical present. And it all been very, very, very clear. And you recognize that was the best that the Old Testament could do. Huh? Hallelujah. But that hag's dead. Amen. That I might be married unto another. No. People, you shouldn't say that. That's what the Word of God says. Huh? That hag's dead. That hag's been cast out. Huh? Huh? Mount Horeb's gone. Hallelujah. It was sacred for a time with God's presence upon it, but Mount Horeb is gone. And Hagar was a mistake from the beginning anyways. And she'd been cast out. That's what Galatians chapter 4 is all about. It's to show us that a whole new and glorious and living way has come for you and me, that we've now stepped in behind the veil. We stepped in through the veil of his own being. To the veil of his own life. We have an entrance now to where the God says, doesn't say, no, you got to fill the place up with smoke lest you should gaze upon me and look at me. He says, come on in and stare. He says, come on in and stare. All you that are far away and all of you that are near, come on in and stare. Come on, sit down. Let's have a meal together. Let's eat. Let's fellowship a while. Father wants to give you an understanding that you may know these wonderful things. He wants to give you this understanding that you may know him.
Thank you, Jesus.
It is a beautiful thing to know that you've been born of God. The wicked one cannot touch you. They knew that. John knew that. 1 John 5:18. He knew that, but we don't know that. Because we believed another doctrine. We believed another form of Jesus. We believed in another Jesus. And there's other people that are standing up. There's people of his choosing, of his making, standing up today. And I'm going to tell you right now, never, never in the history of humanity, never in the history of the church has the things of God been received when they were first spoken, like, oh, this is just what I've been waiting for. Not among the religious. You get stoned, put to death, mock, whatever else, an outcast, and then one day, God begins to breathe on the thing and nobody can resist his word anymore. I've been praying. The Lord's put his prayer in our heart. Oh God, we pray that men will begin to shake like the leaves of a tree in the windstorm at your presence. And the Lord just tells, you know what the Lord says to me? He says, come on in a little bit. Come on in here a little bit closer. Come on in. Go just a little bit deeper. You have to work on that at home. Come on in just a little bit. Just a little bit. Just a little bit closer. Come on in. Come on in. Let's go just a little bit deeper. Come on in. One day the Spirit of the Lord is speaking to me, and the Lord called me to realize. He says, listen. He says, the Spirit, it was a number of things that the Lord said, and I don't want to go through all of that right now. But the Lord says, I want to show you my holiness. I want to reveal my holiness to you. I want you to come to know about holiness. And I said, well, Lord, I just wrote a commentary on the book of Leviticus. Lord, I've been raised in the holiness movement. And this was my conversation. I know it sounds stupid, but nonetheless. You know, I argue with Father. I want to show you about holiness. Well, I know about it. What are you talking about? He said, no, I want you to understand the holiness that is defined only by being here in my throne room, being standing before me. So, Lord, can I do that? Can I really do that with all the other stuff that's going on in this life around me? Can I really do that with all these things? You know, here's me. The Lord brings all these people in and they're already gone. No, it's been a slow bleed going right out the door. You know why? Because I'm not talking what people want to hear. I'm talking about radical change. I'm talking about come out from among them, be separate. I'm talking about friendship with the world as an act of hostility against God. Where you just sit there and you just listen to HBO and the comedian and all the foul stuff coming out of his mouth and you're ha 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 ha. That's demonic. That's of the world. You smell like the world, look like the world, act like the world, think like the world. Conclusion, you're of the world. And the love of God is not in you. He's coming with judgment, indignation against the world, against its sin, against its wickedness, against its rebellion. Rebellion. Humanism says not so. God says it is so. I was talking to a person just not too long ago, and they said, look, I began to minister to them, and said, listen, the word of God, I have chose. I said, from a humanistic perspective, I can justify and make right anything that goes on the planet. Anything you do and anyone else does. But I've given myself over to the Word of God, and because of the Word of God, and I believe it's God's Word and what He demands of us, I give myself no latitude to turn to the right or to the left, but to do exactly what He says to do, because I believe that is the only right way. That's the only way that we're going to hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. The written word became the living word and showed us exactly what God said when He wrote it. The written word became the living word to show us exactly what God meant when He said it. Amen. Are you listening to me? Yes. There are people who are without excuse. Huh? Somebody posted on Facebook, said, I wish people would fact check before they put it on Facebook that Facebook might be a better place. I was thinking, I wish the church would do that. I wish God's people would fact check what they believe in the Word of God, that the church might be a better place. If everybody would begin to live by the Word of God, if everybody would begin to live by the Spirit, walk in the Spirit, come on, if you'd understand the joy and the glory and the beauty and the splendor of it. And I'm telling you right now, you get filled up with God, Satan comes along with this lust, and you go, hey, man, I don't want nothing of this. That stinks. Dude, that stinks. Huh? It's like the guys who went out from the ranch and they thought that they could take a cow that had been dead overnight, and they could skin it out and take it to the butcher. They showed up at the butcher with the thing, and you could smell it two blocks away. You want us to butcher this and package it? Whoa, it stinks, man. Won't you accept Jesus? Whew. Smells of rotten flesh. You want us to package that and eat it? It's trying to present things. You know nothing about the process. You know nothing about the way it's supposed to be done. Yeah, it smelled bad to you, but you weren't a person who worked in a meat packaging plant and knows what good fresh meat smells like, so you could smell it a block away. And suddenly, after somebody pointed out, you say, yeah, that is a little foul smelling. I thought we'd get past that. You convinced yourself of something that wasn't true. Oh, if we could just begin to just let the Word of God convince us of what is true. Let me read a couple of verses of scriptures to you. Somebody says, why can't you keep on one subject? Because I got about 100 subjects here. And I am keeping on one subject, and I'm just bringing the 100 subjects that sit before me or so. Hallelujah. And the plus the ones that are looking through the little glass right there, peering through the window via the web. Hallelujah. I just tell you, somebody said, will you mentor me? I'd say, you don't want me to mentor you. I'm going to tell you because you're doing too many things wrong. It won't be valuable to you. Because I'm on you constantly. That's wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong. So why don't you just do this? Why don't you go deep with Jesus, get all that get all that settled away, start reading the Word of God and living the Word of God, start doing what's said from the pulpit, let that have its perfect work, and then let's see what God will do. Because then we may be able to get together and talk about what's right. You know? Because we want to just go ahead and start, go on, move on with God with a whole load of wrong in their lives. You can't do that. And then all of a sudden you start bringing out the switch. Huh? You start bringing out the correction. You bringing out the chastening of which every son is a partaker of. Everybody's going, that's not love. It's not love to chasten. It's not love to instruct. It's not love to point out where I'm wrong and what's hindering me from moving on with God. Rebuke is not a dirty word. It's one that God demands. It is. Amen. Amen. It is. I rarely do that. All I'm doing is just basically just in most correcting. I mean, rebuke is a strong thing. That's how you talk to the devil. You know what I'm saying? It's a word. That's how it's used in the scripture. That's how you talk to the devil, cast something out. Or to religion. You can rebuke religion. Yes. And it's a voice. It's a strong voice. I mean, it's the stuff that Paul would say when he said, if anybody sins, rebuke them before everyone. Hey, come here. Come here. Stand up here. I'll just bring out point of what happened here is so-and-so's life. And you rebuke them before all. That everybody may fear. Ha ha! You try to do that today, you won't have one person left in the meeting. Well, no, I would because Ann loves me so much. Even my children would ultimately get so embarrassed over me, they'd probably have to leave. Now, the Lord does it. I asked the Lord one day, I said, Lord, am I unwilling to bear the reproach with you and bear the persecution with you and not do your word? Because, I mean, I set myself, just try this on for size. Set yourself to doing everything that's written in the Word. Now, it's good to make fact check, truth check, and make sure that you understand exactly what's being said, which is going to be some study. Huh? And there's many days we start in the Word of God in the morning, 7, 8 o'clock in the morning, and I turn around and it's like, oh my goodness, it's 4 o'clock. We need to get something, do something. Got to get this other stuff taken care of. Because the Word of God will consume you. It's a beautiful thing. Whew. I pray that all of you will be able to come and know what a beautiful thing it is. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I start reading and gazing at the Word of God, becoming captivated by His promises and all the things that He did and all the people that interacted with Him, and the atmosphere has changed. I've got one plan. I've set myself on with one. I got one plan for life. I want to see Jesus. I want to know Him who loved me so much He redeemed me with His own blood. I want to know Him who poured out the grace and the glory of heaven upon my soul that I might be everything that is acceptable and holy to Him. That gives me an empowerment so that Satan comes and has nothing in me. That the wicked one cannot touch me. Who leads me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Who doesn't lead me into temptation but delivers me from the evil. I mean, come on, man.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. it's about time the church get captivated with the glory of his person, the glory of his ways, rather than being constantly compromised and conflicted. Because you're not going to have any hell in heaven. Heaven is 100% absent of hell. Zero hell. Zero devil influence. Zero of those things that many people who sit in the church love. The Lord says, he said, I will destroy those who have pleasure in unrighteousness. You just have to ask yourself, do you have pleasure in unrighteousness? God said, I will destroy those who have pleasure in unrighteousness. Hello? I just blew the head off of humanism. You know what I'm telling you? I took a sword of the Spirit and took the head off of humanism. There's only one way, and it's not bigotry. It's God's way, because there's only one way of life. Man cannot do life, because there's only one way of life. He cannot reproduce life. He can have as many dead corpses, give him as many dead cadavers as you can bring into the place. Not one person can produce life, because there's only one kind of life. There's only one kind of life that produces the love, the joy, the peace, the everything that we like, everything that is good, the blessing, where all of your children are walking with God and full of the Holy Ghost. That only happens by one way. And again, there's not three or four different ways. There's one uncompromising way that happens. It's true. And now our society teaches us, oh, don't put that kind of pressure or that kind of influence, and go so far as to call it control on your kids. Turn them over to the teacher and let them do that. Turn them over to the teacher and let them. I'm going to tell you right now, because that's not what's being said, but that's what is equated to. That's the actual outcome. I'm interested in the outcome, what really actually transpires, rather than all of the verbiage surrounding it. Hello. I'm interested in, I don't just look at something and say, oh, wow, that works. Look at the clock works. I like to take the thing apart and say, how does that work? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Come on, people. We need to investigate a little bit deeper here. I don't know why anybody would want to hang on to a demonic fellowship and demonic relationship after having seen a glimpse of heaven, while people want to stay in hell anyways. I don't know. I've met another Jesus than other people have. I've met another Jesus. Somebody says, does that mean that you don't get tempted? No, I get tempted. But I'm going to tell you right now, any temptation that would result in a disobedience would produce within my life great sorrow and grief that I don't want it ever happen again. Somebody said, you perfect? No, but I want to be. Someone said, you sinless? No, but I want to be. And there's a big difference between that and, oh, nobody's perfect. We all that. Nobody walks in pure, perfect righteousness. And just act like that you can just go on. We all lie and we all cheat and steal and whatever, you know. No, we don't all lie, cheat, and steal. And murder and rape and let's go, witchcraft. I've been doing that lately. One time a preacher was saying to me, Mark, what are you preaching? You're preaching about living in righteousness and purity. What are you talking about? I said, I'm just talking about walking in the Spirit. He said, well, I'm really not sure. I said, well, let me help you. I said, have you had a problem with adultery lately? He goes, well, no, of course not. I said, okay, well, good. There's one of 18. We're 1/18th of the way there. How about fornication? You've been doing that lately? Well, of course not. I said, are you catching on? He said, I think I'm hearing you. I said, how about lasciviousness? You've been involved at looking at people who are not dressed properly and inciting immorality in you. And he goes, well, I don't want to be. I said, well, good. I said, now, how about witchcraft? You've been doing that lately? He said, well, of course not. Well, we're doing pretty good. We got like 3 for 4. And I can help you with that third one that you're having a problem with. Shut your television off, man. Huh? Quit going to the beach if you don't, you know. Why would people go to the beach anyways? Well, the reason we go to the beach is to go surfing, to go paddle way out. Just go hang out and watch everybody run around naked. And it's a place to go pick up, you know, demonic activity. Oh, you don't say we can't go to the beach. Now, if you want to go to the beach that bad, I can show you some places nobody's hanging out there. And right now is a great time to go to the beach. But come June, everybody's going to be showing off their new nothing. Their new string that they call clothing. who can have the least amount of clothes and not be arrested for indecent. Jesus, help us. And it's just this crazy mindset. And too many people that go to church are out there in the midst of it. You don't want to hear come out from among them. Be separate, says the Lord, and I shall receive you, and you'll be my people, and I'll be your God. Come out from among them. Oh, no, that's for the Amish. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18 wasn't written for the Amish. The Lord stands on the other side of the world. He stands on the other side of the flood. He's opposite from everything that belongs to the world. God has absolutely nothing to do with the world. Those who are friends with the world are enemies of God. He says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. All that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. And then a preacher comes along and tells you that the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life is on the inside of you, and you got to work on it. Well, if you got to work on it, having begun in the Spirit, you're not going to get any head. You're not going to get any head. Well, you made perfect by your own human ability. There's nothing to work on. It's finished. Salvation is complete. He's completed it all. He's finished it all. He's done it in full. He's come and delivered us from our sin. He is Almighty God's help. He's Almighty God's salvation. He's Almighty God's redemption for you and me. All you and I got to do is learn how to be obedient. You were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. Every day of your life, you were shaped to be like the devil. The moment you call upon the name of the Lord Jesus, you're born again. And that day you're born in righteousness to now be shaped in purity every day, to be shaped like the Holy Ghost, to grow and mature in the ways of God. And the blood of Jesus Christ is there to cleanse us and from all unrighteousness as we're growing, as we're maturing, as we're learning to stand fully in Him and completely say no to everything that Satan would throw at us. He's come to deliver us from out of the evil. There's no temptation that comes to us except for what we're able to say no. But to hear many preachers say today, every temptation, nobody can say no. And it's just the opposite. It's Antichrist spirit saying opposite of the Word of God. Blessed is the man who stands against temptation and does not submit to it, for he shall receive a crown of life that fades not away. A crown of life, a crown of righteousness. Hallelujah. And then people come along and preach just the opposite. And we wonder why we're in the mess. And then those churches explode in growth because you can do whatever you want to do. Come in here. We're going to give you a religious fix and make you feel good about yourself while you continue on in sin. You're going to have to renounce the world. You're going to have to renounce sin. That's called repentance. People never set free from demonic powers because they don't call sin, sin. They call sin common, ordinary, acceptable to God. Jesus came. You should call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. Listen to this. Galatians 1:4, Paul says, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins. Thank you, Jesus. You bore my sin in your own body on the tree, that now I, being dead, a state of being dead to sin, being dead to sin, sin has no power upon me and no hold upon me, no interest to me. Now I, being dead to sin, might live unto righteousness, by whose wound or stripes I was healed. Think about it. What do you think about it? Here Paul says, Jesus Christ himself, Jesus gave himself, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil world. Jesus says, you're not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. After its culture, after its fashion, don't look like it, don't act like it, don't think like it, don't talk like it, don't move like it, don't dress like it, don't smell like it, don't be like it. Behold, he's coming. This isn't, oh, now this is a throwback to, you know, antiquity. Somebody said, are you a preacher out of the medieval time? I said, I go further back than that. I'm further back than medieval, I tell you right now. Are you a preacher right out of the 9th century? No, I'm going right out of the 1st century. There is no time spent in this gospel. I'm living in the day. I'm living in the year, the acceptable year of the Lord. It's not about what I believe. It's about what God has said. And the Spirit of the Lord is proclaiming these things out of me. And it's verified by the word, because I'm going to preach the word, speak the word. He that does not speak the word is because there is no light in him. There's no truth in him. We're going to declare God's word. Somebody said, oh, it's works. It's not a work salvation where you by merit are earning a relationship with God. It is the overflow of the Holy Ghost now living in our lives, producing within us everything that is seen in Father himself and Christ Jesus himself. It's deeds. It's the doings of the Spirit. It's the very life and movements of Almighty God in my mouth and in my heart, in my hands, in my feet, in my legs, in my being, in my body. I'm his temple, the purchased possession, to glorify God in my body and my spirit, which are his. Come on now. I am crucified with Christ. I'm buried with him by baptism into his death. I'm raised up together with him. I'm alive together with him. I'm seated together with him in the heavenly realm. What other kind of life are you wanting me to live? What are the things you're saying? You're saying, I can't have that, I can't be that? You're saying, I can't be full of the Holy Ghost? Well, you're too late, I already am. You're saying, I have to be like you to be right with God? No, thank you. I tell you, I want to be like Jesus in everything. He is my life. He's the author and finisher of my faith. He's the captain of my salvation. He's the leader of the troop. He's the one that we're following. We his disciples. He's the one who's mentoring us. He's showing us everything that pleases the Father. He's the one who comes in the volume of the book from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. Come on, people. Let's just do this thing, man. Let's just take a hold of what God says in his word and start living it out. Let's just turn everything off. Turn everything off around you. If you turn everything off around you, it'll get real bright. If you just shut everything down around you, it'll become, the room will become full of his divine glory. The same one who said this. Somebody said, they got all these crazy different interpretations. And believe me, you can find somebody say anything you have a mind for them to say about this verse of Scripture. But the same one that said that said this right over here in Colossians 1:13. Go look at that. Look at Colossians 1:13. He said, having delivered us from the power of darkness, he translated us into the kingdom of the dear son. I'm in the kingdom. I'm completely delivered from the powers of darkness. That means sin. That means iniquity. That means the world. That means the judgment against all sin and iniquity. What does Jesus say? The one who took away our sins and blew our sins away. He said the Holy Ghost is going to come and he's going to prosecute sin. That's what he said. He will reprove sin. That's what the Holy Ghost does. Men come along and say, sin's okay. God, the Holy Ghost says, you're damned if you do it. Hello? The wages, God, the Holy Ghost comes along and says, the wages of sin results in death. As much as it resulted, disobedience resulted in the death of Adam and Chava, or Adam and Eve, it results in your death today. That's what he says. Somebody said, well, I don't believe that. Well, then you ought to read what Jesus said to the 7 churches. I have somewhat against you. I mean, you know what? When he gets finished with the church at Ephesus, you're thinking, woo, I would like to be a part of that church. In fact, you go read what Paul said about the church at Ephesus, and you go, that is a seriously good church. You know who was the itinerant pastors and leaders of that church? Paul and John. Whoa, what a church. What a church. Now, Paul's dead. He's been beheaded. Okay? According to tradition, we don't know that for sure, but according to tradition, he was beheaded. And we believe that because he was a Roman citizen. We know that Rome put him to death. Nero put him to death, so we assume. But we know what was going on with John. He was exiled. They tried to boil him in oil. Didn't boil. That's tradition. We don't know that from the Word of God. Pretty good tradition, though. Exiled to the Isle of Patmos at this time. He said, put him out there on that rock. Put him out there on that remote island camp out there. He's out there. And the Lord says, you tell church at Ephesus. And you read about everything that church at Ephesus is doing. And of course, it's near and dear to his heart. He was involved in all seven of those churches, by the way. He said, but you tell them I have somewhat against them. And they better repent. You hear me? That's why we repent preachers. Jesus repent preachers. Somebody said, oh, you like John the Baptist. Your problem, you'd have to be more influential if you just quit being John the Baptist. You're just going to get your head chopped off because you're John the Baptist. No, I'm going to be Jesus and get crucified.
Hallelujah. Yes, that's right.
Ha ha, gotcha. Well, I just want to argue. I don't want to argue. I'm just telling you, man, we got to be Jesus. And this way, if you're going to pull out some kind of allegory about me, I'm going to pull out the allegory about him. I want to talk about Jesus, not John. I'm not following John. I'm following Jesus. Jesus was more of a repentance preacher than John was. Hallelujah. He was. And then, I mean, I could go on and on in this, but you just look over at Titus 3:5, where Paul defines salvation. He defines salvation as being washed with the water of being made a new creation. Being washed with the water, and he uses the word of regeneration, a new being, regeneration. The word, genemon, is new, a new being, a new genetics, because it's from the Greek word genan that we receive the word gene, gene, spelled the same way. A new gene, a new genetics, a new genealogy. A new birth. By the way, you talk about getting clean. You get real clean. Huh? When something is destroyed and it started all over with a new creation, a new birth, a new beginning, a new being. Washed with, that's some serious washing, that's some serious scrubbing. You can't get any cleaner than that. Washed with the, he says, saved. Look at it. Saved by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost. Somebody say, come in and renew. I don't need to be renewed. I've been renewed. You can't get me any more renewed than I am. Hallelujah. Do I want more of a flow of the Holy Ghost? Absolutely. Do I want a greater increase in the manifestation of the power of God in my life? I only want to increase with the increase of God. I was telling the Lord the other day, I was telling him how he has to use me more. And he was helping me understand he don't have to use me more. I'm just telling him, you need me. Your labors are few. You need me. And the Lord helps us to understand. I know exactly where you are. And I'm going to use you when I'm ready. I'm going to use you more when I'm ready. But I'm going to stay. And even though I know that, I'm going to use me more when I'm ready. I'm still desperate. Oh, God, use me. Use me now, though. Use me. Let me have an increase. I don't want an increase without the increase of God. Hallelujah. Lord, just you can, if you need to keep me over here in a more desperate situation, if that's the way I'm going to grow, that's fine. A lot of things grow and increase under pressure. Huh? Come on. That's fine. I'm going to let Father's will be done. I'm never going to find myself separated from Father's will. I'm going to say, Father, your will be done. I'm acknowledging you in all my ways, and I know exactly what you're going to do. And you can't say, well, I'm acknowledging God in all my ways, and so he's directing my path, and you live in a life of disobedience. No, that's nonsense. If you acknowledging God in all your ways, it's going to result in him directing you. Listen, on what level? Being led by the Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit of holiness. Walk in the Holy Spirit, huh? Living in the Holy Spirit, Spirit of holiness. Hallelujah. So what does that mean? What does holiness mean? Holiness can only be defined by the person of God, the presence of God. It's being with him. Mount Sinai, Mount Horeb became a place, a holy place, only because God's presence was there. Take God's presence away and it's no more holy. You hear me? Can you hear me today? I want you guys to, I want you, every one of these people in this place to step into a communion with God, into a realm of joy unspeakable and full of glory, into a place that passes all peace that passes all understanding, an overwhelming beauty and splendor of heaven, that all you want is just more of this. A more of that. Which he's opened up the door for everyone. Everyone, anywhere, at any time, any place. He says, the washing of, he tells us, the washing, the water of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. To emphasize what it means to be born again. Have you been born again? Have you been born from above? Have you been born of God? The old life ceased to exist. The former conversation ceased to exist. This is how God challenges us. He's radical about it. Nicodemus said, how can a person enter into his mother's womb the second time when he's old? Jesus said, heaven will come upon you. You must be born of the Spirit, hallelujah, and born of the water. Otherwise, you can't know the kingdom of God. You can't see the kingdom of God. You can't enter into the kingdom. Not now, not later. Understand the theology of Nicodemus. He was a person, a part of the kingdom of God, in the covenant of the kingdom of God. And here's a prophet he recognizes come from God telling him, no, you're not in the kingdom of God. You can't see the kingdom of God. You can't know the kingdom of God until the Holy Ghost comes upon you and creates a new creation. Until the Spirit of the Lord comes upon you. And of course, Nicodemus, knowing the word of God as he did, he would have immediately thought, he'd have immediately thought about Saul. Oh, the Spirit of the Lord came upon him and he came and he received a new heart. And he became the anointed of God. He could go through all the list of the things about the coming Redeemer and the mystery of the water of the Holy Spirit that would be poured out upon all men, spoke of from all throughout the Word of God, like Isaiah chapter 12, Joel chapter 2, and the list goes on. Because they were well versed in the Word. And so all that was beginning. All that was coming to a focus now in Jesus says, you must be born of the Holy Ghost. You must be born of the Spirit of the living God. People, you think people would be so excited jumping out of their seats. You mean I get to be born of God? You mean I get to be one who has the Spirit of God in him? You mean I can be completely set free from darkness and the devil and the powers of hell? I'm getting ready to go to Kashmir. Everybody said, don't go to Kashmir, you're going to die. I'm going to Kashmir Valley. Oh, you can't go to Kashmir Valley. Why don't you start off, go to, you know, the outskirts of Juma to start with or something. I'm going to Kashmir Valley. Oh, well, you know why? Because it's the same way. When we stood in 2006 in Nepal for the first time and we presented the gospel, the Hindus came by the thousands. You mean I can have my sins washed away? You mean I can have the Spirit of God come on the inside of me? Real simple gospel message. Of your sins being completely cleansed and the Spirit of God coming on the inside of you and you being born of God and becoming immediately united with the living God. They just came. No matter where I was at, they came by the thousands. No matter where we were at. Literally. And then it was there. See, it was there that God showed me how, began to show me how to reach the unreached people groups. Because we think, well, the saints have got to get right before we can go there. No. I was standing on the platform. I received an open vision from heaven. Ann and I are standing on the platform. I received an open vision from heaven. I said, the 40-year war will come to an end. It comes to an end. The 40-year war comes to an end. And peace comes upon the nation of Nepal. And I also saw in the open vision, I saw the government recognize the church as an ally and not a foe. And that the churches would be organized under the government of Nepal. Within 3 months, both happened. To this day, how many years later? The Federation of Churches and the presidents and the group and the board of the Federation of Churches, they're going strong. Now Nepal is about to fall apart. I'm saying, look, God told me to do a crusade in Western Nepal last year, and you guys couldn't get on board with it because you said things were a little rough and you were concerned about everybody's safety. And now it's even worse. I said, can't you remember 2006, how bad it was? War was going on between the Maoists and the Nepali government. Look at you would go to prison. Look at what was going on. Look at what change happened when the gospel of Jesus Christ was presented. When you have threatening powers coming out, imposing powers coming out against the gospel, whether it's your life as a person or a nation, it's only the power of the gospel that can turn that thing. And everybody's standing there, well, you know, we could do something, you know, like we did in 2012, and we just have smaller group meetings. I said, no, it's got to be advertised on billboards. It's got to be bring the buses, fill them up. We actually, God set it up in 2006, that we actually had the crusade on government property on the grounds in which the government cabinet met. That's how the Lord said it. Then they, of course, went to the National Stadium. I said, no. We've got to bring buses. It's got to be on billboards. No, but if we do that, then all the radical Hindus who's trying to move Nepal back from being a secular to a religious state, they're all going to be there, and we're going to get killed and put in prison and die. Good. Let's do that. We're in heaven then. Why are you holding on to your life? You're not willing to risk it, man. That's why you can't see the glory. That's why you can't engage in all that the Word of God describes that you and I are supposed to be and have. Because you won't risk it for Him. You want some little safety place so you can have your own life and do it your way. Have your own thoughts. Throw your temper tantrums and whatever else. You know what I'm saying? Because you didn't get what you wanted for Christmas. Or whatever. No, I'm not just talking on a national level. I'm talking on an individual level. It has to be a reality in my life before God's going to use me there. But he said, you can't go to Kashmir. Well, I was born to take the gospel to the unreached people groups. I was born, there's over 3 billion people who've never heard. You know, every time I've been in a nation, and the Lord just, every nation that we've been in, I'm telling you, before the Lord, every nation we've been in, by the time we've done one meeting, we had so many meetings that people wanted us to do, our lives would have been just, they never wanted us to leave Nepal. They never wanted us to leave when we first did a crusade in Papua New Guinea. Never wanted us to leave there. Never wanted us to leave in China. I mean, I got so much stuff to do in China, I can't even do it. Wherever we went, wherever God's taken us, there's so many places and to do meetings and just run full time. And every time I'm like, Father, I could be so much more effective here. I mean, when I went into a remote jungle place. You talk about backwards out there, nowhere's land, you know. How can you reach the people out here? I'm telling you, the first night, Joshua and Daniel were with me. The first night, it was just a few people in the building. The next night, the place was packed. They brought dump trucks, loads of people. I mean, it just explodes. We get in, we do a meeting, and there's 5,000 people. Then there's, the next night, there's triple that. And the next night, it's double that and beyond, because now you can't even count. You don't even know. You can't count 30 to 40 to 50,000 people. You don't even know. It's a huge amount of people, as far as you can see. Lord, surely I can do more here. And every time the Lord would say, no, I want you to go back to San Diego, because I'm going to do something there that's bigger. Every time. And so I'm thinking, well, then I'm coming here to talk to you because God's going to use you. He's going to raise you up, and then it's going to be multiplied that way. But who knows what God's going to do? And in some respects, many years ago, back 1981, 1982, something like that. I had a heavenly vision, a glorious heavenly vision of where it was called Jack Murphy Stadium at that time. As we call it, I don't know what you call it now, Qualcomm or something. And where there was, all the lights were off in the county. There was only one glow. I could only say that it seemed as though all the lights were off because the glow was so great coming from that stadium. And you could hear the shout and the thunders of heaven from Otay Mesa to San Onofre, from the west, from the coast right out here to Warner Hot Springs, which covers the whole of the county. You know, it takes one day for God to do that. See, Hosea 6:3 says he comes to us as the early and the latter rain. The early and latter rain speaks of in the scripture as the movings of God, both in the Old Testament and the New Testament. And it's the sovereign movings of God. And Father spoke to me not too long ago. Where was I at? I think I was in Dubai. And the Spirit of the Lord began to just deal with me right from the Word of God. God, this is how Father speaks to me. He quotes scriptures to me. Huh. Did you know that's just the way he speaks? That's the way Jesus, look at Jesus. He just quotes scripture. Amen. He's quoted Deuteronomy. Look at what Deuteronomy, somebody said the Old Testament is gone. Well, it worked very effectively for Jesus. He quotes Deuteronomy 8:10, and look what happened. Man should not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. I challenge you, quit living your life for yourself, because it could come to an end, and tomorrow you're going to be in eternity. Another moment and you're in eternity. Another moment, I tell you right now, you listen to me, another moment and you're in eternity. And there's only, Jesus said, the word which I have delivered to you will judge you in that day. And we have proof that this is the word of God. His word is confirmed with his miracles and signs and wonders. His, in his mercy and grace, so willing to convince men that he will even do miracles and wonders among the rebellious. And he says, even the foolish, those who are void of understanding, cannot miss the signpost or err in the way or take a wrong direction. In the movings of God. I'm expecting the great movings of God. I don't know. Perhaps what God will do is so great in Southern California that it will shock the world. I don't know how it. I know that right now I'm from Southern California. The nations of the earth are impacted. And I've been in the most backwards places on the earth. I mean, I was in. We had a person here the other day from Minya, Egypt. You talk about coming from the sticks. Well, there's no sticks there. Just desert. But it is so backwards. It's like they living not like they were 100 years ago, like in Mississippi. Ha, ha, ha. People are in Mississippi. But it's like she's living like they were 2,000 years ago. And there, I'm in this little crazy little rundown hotel in Minya, Egypt. I turn on the television, and what's on? MTV from L.A. MTV. Go into the jungles of Irianjaya. And what's going to be on the, they got a little TV with a little satellite dish, and they're watching what's coming out of L.A. I don't know what all Father's going to do, but it's going to be big. And he told me, he said, if you're laboring to produce and cultivating the fruit that I demand, when I come, you'll cultivate it with me. There's a lot of people cultivating other fruit. They want other results. They've got other ideas. They're trying to promote it. They're trying to produce it. And they're not just staying right with God, what God said in his words. Here's what I want. See, the husbandman has long patience until he first receives the early and the latter rain. Be patient under the coming of the Lord Jesus. For the husbandman has long patience until he receives the precious fruit of the earth. That's produced from the early and the latter rain. The movings, his sovereign movings. I'm going to be cultivating the fruit. See, we're laborers together with the Lord of his husbandry and of his building. I'm supposed to be cultivating in your life those things that God wants to cultivate. We're supposed to be cultivating together those things that Father has purposed to produce. You want to know what heaven's like? Heaven's like this. Heaven looks like the Garden of Eden. This is what I believe. It looks like what you see in the Garden of Eden when God created Adam and Eve, Adam and Chava, in the garden. It's called the paradise. But it has Christ Jesus at the center and all of his saints gathered around. Do you fit in? I'm like, I'm there. No, I fit in. I'm there right now. There's a lot of people in church this morning. They don't even fit in there. There's no TV. There's no football game. There's no lust. There's no unrighteousness. There's no iniquity. There's no go do this and go do that with a demonic realm. Jesus was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. That's why John said, he that sins is of the devil, because you got to participate with a demon spirit to sin. That's what he said. He said, don't let anybody deceive you. He that does righteousness is righteous even as he is righteous. That's a whole lot of righteous. Amen. Amen. He that sin is of the devil. And for this cause, the Son of God was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. Hallelujah. I fit in with God. I'm not on the outside. I'm not a foreigner with him. I'm a foreigner in this world. Hallelujah. I don't want, everybody's all excited about having pleasure in unrighteousness. I have no pleasure there. What are you guys excited about? I don't want nothing to do with you guys. Nothing. Because I cannot relate to your demonic activity. I can't relate to your demonic fun. I can't relate to your carousing with everything that hates God while you say you love him. Say, oh, I love God. Yeah, you love God, I'm sure, but it's the wrong one. He's got a little g. He's the prince of the power of the air. Somebody tried to argue with me. He said, oh, you need to change the Greek word. Instead of heaven, it should be atmosphere. I said, no. You're thinking about the wrong God. We're going to keep it heaven and let Satan stay in the atmosphere. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. And then we'll come in and invade the atmosphere and change it and make it heaven. Hallelujah. I'm not half done. And I know I've already run out of time. I'm not half done. I'm not half done trying to convince you that heaven's worth living in. And not after you die, right now while you're living right here. The Father has a promise for you to have life right now. And after this life, after you step out of this realm, even a more a gloriously heavenly realm to be found there. You can't have the world in hell too. You can't have the world in heaven too. You can't have the things that belong to the demonic and the things that belong to the Spirit of God. You can't. They won't be mixed. As long as you're carousing around, sitting at the table of devils, the same person who wrote Galatians 1:4 says you can't sit at the table of the Lord, because how can you have fellowship with God and have fellowship with Beelzebub? Or in other words, he's literally saying, how can you say you're of the Lord and be Baalites? Because Jezebel's religion still goes on today. Because Jezebel's religion started with Nimrod long before her. And Nimrod's interaction with the demonic darkness was also in Cush. And evidently Ham opened up a door to it. And we see that rebellion ultimately traced all the way to Antichrist. And he goes right back and sits up his throne right where Nimrod founded his throne in Babylon. And created the name of the city and created the name of the country. In his desire to make God pay. Now, this is in the scripture, but this is in the other writings like the book of Enoch. To make God pay for drowning men in the flood. That's Nimrod's claim to fame. Nimrod literally means, it is the root word, Nimra, literally means rebel. Baalites. Worshippers of Baal. The queen of heaven. The mother of harlots. Who's drunk on the blood of saints. Killing them. Anyone who speaks his word. Anyone who stands in the realm and opposes the satanic. The only opposition the Antichrist has is people like me, full of the Holy Ghost. He will focus on the anointing to destroy the anointing, to dilute it, to neutralize it, whatever. Whatever he can do, he's going to do whatever he can do. And I pray in Jesus' name, you'll stand up as part of the army of God and say, I know whose side I'm on. I can stand against all these things. There's no temptation coming at me except for which is common unto man. God's made a way the way I can escape it. I know who I'm believed in, and I'm persuaded that he's able to keep me. I know that I'm not only filled with the spirit of holiness, but the spirit of holiness surrounds me. I'm immersed in him, baptized in him. I'm not going to be conformed to this world, but I'm going to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. I'm going to let the Holy Ghost show me who he is. I'm going to let the Holy Ghost show me how to love him, show me how to obey him, because it's the spirit of obedience. Jesus was made, revealed to be the Son of God by power and by the spirit of holiness, the spirit of obedience. There's a spirit of disobedience and there's a spirit of obedience. The spirit of disobedience is the demonic realm. The spirit of obedience is the working of the Holy Ghost. I'm going to come clean. I'm going to stand on the side of God. Men are going to gather themselves together and they're going to make God an alien and they're going to try to fight against him with Satan leading the charge, but they will not win. The book is written. And everything that is there. I remember back in the 30s being told about from preacher friends, my father and others, about back in the 30s and even in the mid 40s. where the preachers were saying, oh, the Word of God says that Israel become a nation again. Everybody said, oh, that's just allegorical. You are crazy. You're out of your mind. You take the Bible literal. You're a literalist. You're a fundamentalist. That will never happen. That is impossible. Behold. People say that Jerusalem is no longer trodden down under the foot of the Gentiles. That's nonsense. I heard these supposed great prophets that people have exalted because they're, I'm not going to say it. Leave it. I want to say it. I mean, many of them are. Baalites. They're Baalites. They're not worshipers of the living God, the eternal God. I can prove it by their deeds, by their works. And here they're saying, oh, then Jerusalem has not been trodden down. It was liberated and not trodden down to the Gentiles in 1967. What? You don't have any idea what you're saying. The Dome of the Rock stands upon the Temple Mount. It's right where Antiochus Epiphanes put up his abomination. It's right where Tiberius put up his abomination. It's where the Muslims have had their abomination there since the 8th century. Is it 8th or 9th century? Did they begin to put their... I know it was fully manifested by the 12th, 13th century, right? Because of the Crusades, correct, everybody? All you history people. I like being around people who can... You just lay hold of these things. I understand these things. I'm going to tell you what. It's going to come down. Somebody said, oh, ISIS is the Antichrist. No, it's coming to an end. It's coming to an end. Because the Dome of the Rock will be erased and the temple will be built upon the mountain before the Antichrist ever comes. You hearing me? Because he's got to have a temple for there to be an abomination of desolation. And God's got to do something unique for it to even be made desolate, for it has to be inhabited before it can be made desolate. Uh-oh. And there's reasons. There's much written about that in Ezekiel, but people don't even... It's like, we're just going to go ahead, do whatever it is we're going to do, believe whatever it is we're going to believe, forget the Word of God. Because it don't fit in nice, neat little packages of what we think is going to happen. No, people. God's Word is going to... Everything that He said has come to pass. And everything that hasn't come to pass yet will come to pass. And it's proof after proof after proof after proof. But I'm going to tell you right now, when you come under the influence of rebellion and the spirit of darkness, the Red Sea can open up before and you can walk on dry land. Manna can come down from heaven. You can be under a cloud of fire by night and a cloud of glory by day. And still you're wondering whether or not God is true. Maybe He doesn't even really exist. Deception knows no boundaries. Huh? Islam's coming down. This day's numbered. Yep, you're going to tell me that the Antichrist is going to come out of Mohammedism and his fundamental icon and right to exist? Because I'm telling you right now, the Dome of the Rock is as big as Mecca. It's as big as the Rock of Mecca. Well, the Rock of Mecca, which is the idol that they bow to, has a huge impact upon them. But the Dome of the Rock is their icon, their insignia. And you think that they're going to champion the world, that they're going to rule the world, and that their icon of representation is going to be erased? Forget about it. It's not true. Everybody's all scared. I'm saying bring ISIS over here. Let's have a conversation. I'm saying I invite all the nations of the earth to send all of their religions because we're about to have a Holy Ghost downpour. Right here in the United States of America. We want all those people who your governments will allow us to come and preach. You got to come on over here. Because we're about to have a great Holy Ghost meeting right here in America. Amen. Satan wants to give out all this propaganda about how all these things are going down, all these conspiracies and all this. You give me a break. I'll tell you right now. Let me give you the Word of God. Jesus Christ has been, His name, the name of Jesus, has been exalted above every name. He is above all principality, power, might, and dominion, and He rules right now in the kingdom of men. He has all authority in heaven and earth. Nothing happens unless He says so. Don't tell me somebody's ruling this and somebody's doing that and somebody's pulling this string. Satan is doing a lot. There's no question about it in the midst of his little group. Actually, it's a big group. But God can do much more in the midst of his little group, far more. just so he can do the bits of his big group. I wanted to go see the tomb of my aunt that hung her in the Boston House of Commons in 1630. She was a preacher. She was a quaking preacher. She had a healing ministry for babies, little children. They hung her, but now while I was there, they told me, oh, no, no, right over there in Massachusetts, they built a monument to her. There's a huge monument. And that right over here in Rhode Island, you can go and see her grave where they buried her. Her family was able to get her body buried because usually they burn a witch. But because they couldn't convince everybody that that's really what she was, I still don't know all the history. But nonetheless, my blood, the blood of my family is here since 1630 for the gospel of Jesus Christ to be advanced in his kingdom. I'm telling you right now, I'm not going to be the oddball out. Hey, man, you know what? We gave our life for it, and you just said, you just abdicated your authority. Christ Jesus has given you and I authority, and he wants us to begin to execute it. We have the authority of the Son of God. Yeah, we're sons. Somebody's going to start screaming and hollering. You're a son, not the son. I know that. But a son is only defined in the Son. Hello. Yeah. And when Paul realized that God purposed to reveal the Son, his only begotten Son, in him, come on, the revelation was complete concerning the new covenant. Yeah. Beloved, now are we the sons of God? Look just like Jesus.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And though it does not appear what we should be, we know that when we see him, we shall see him as he is, for we shall be like him. And everyone who has this hope purifies himself even as he is pure. Yeah. And everybody who doesn't have this hope and just religious and just believes whatever it is they want to believe, they don't do no purifying. Well, you know what it means to purify yourself even as pure? To not allow any of those things in your life. The Holy Ghost, the sanctifying Spirit of God, the separating, setting apart Spirit of the living God steps in and says, that's right. He doesn't step over top of your will. He steps right in the midst of your will and tells Satan and all of his hosts, you heard what the man said.
Amen.
Where God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost makes intercession for everyone, stands up to fight our battles, for none of us are a match against the troops of hell. Now, not a single verse. Satan was able to deceive and lead away the mighty angels of God who stood beholding the face of God throughout the eternity past. If he was able to deceive such mighty angels, what would he do to you? What could he do to you and me? What has he done? But when we walk around in Christ Jesus, you tell me who has the authority in the earth. Huh? Some little rich man sitting in his little pen? Huh? Shouting out his little threats with his little mouth? Or me and you? Give me a break. Come on, people. Hello. It's just time that we begin to understand who we are and what God has purposed us to do, and quit diddle-dallying around with the program. Stand up. In the full glory and expression of the Master's plan. I have many more things to say unto you, but I will not say them right now. Stand with me. Well, about six people that the Lord wanted to transform and change left before I even got 10 minutes into the message. And so, Father, I pray you, God, in your mercy, you mark them. I ask them, Father, right now, you listen to this prayer. Mark them right now, God, and may they have not another moment of sanity. May they have not another moment of rest and false peace, but may they be absolutely under the Holy Ghost conviction, tormented with the reality of their sin and rebellion until they change. Hallelujah. Why? Because I don't want to see me spend eternity in hell. God created a place called hell for the devil and his angels. God said concerning those people who practice sexual immorality, I will destroy their soul in hell. God said he will come with wrath and indignation. So it's what the book of Revelation about. It's how it's a revelation about how God feels about sin. Yes, even yours. And there's only one means of escape. And that is the one Christ Jesus, who came to bear away our sins, who came to deliver us from our sin, who came to set us free from our sin, who came to set us free from the powers of darkness and translate us out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of the dear Son, to come and bring to us all that heaven can afford. You decide today whose side you're on. But I'm going to tell you right now, there's not a person standing in this place that in a very short time, you're going to break the barrier. You know, over there in Paris, when the terrorists came in, they were singing Kiss the Devil. And about the next 5 minutes, they kissed him. Because immediately, they lifted up their eyes, being in torment. Somebody said, how do you know? Because they were in hell. They were in hell. They didn't really change too much, just their location. They were in hell with all of their lust and perversion and the stuff that was going on in that bar as they were seeing Kiss the Devil. All they did was translate it to their eternal location. God's not willing that any man perish. God is long-suffering. He has this enduring patience with men. Somebody said, oh, if God is alive and he really exists, then why does he allow all this sin and iniquity to go on? So he might deliver you. So he might get you. So that you might possibly respond. But I'm going to tell you, sin and its iniquity and its lust, the days are numbered. It's numbered. There's a time appointed in which God should judge the world by the one whom he's appointed, Christ Jesus, by whom also he made the worlds. Made you and me. It's time to get right with God. It's time to decide whose side you're on. Quit falling out to ungodliness. Today, Father wants to seal the deal in your life, and he'll seal it with the Holy Ghost. He'll seal it. He'll seal it with the Spirit of holiness. And there the blood of Jesus Christ will wash you and cleanse you. And if you stumble and fall into sin and get tripped up, his blood will restore you and cleanse you and wash you, because he's there to keep us. He's there to perfect us. He's there to bring us unto that day unblemished, without reproof, without rebuke. All you got to do is be willing to be taught of God. But if you think that you can hold on to the world and justify yourself based upon your philosophical ideologies, your philosophy around Christianity, you're wrong. Your end will be the end as the end of anyone else. Believing on the Lord Jesus Christ is living the life of Jesus, because you receive the life of Christ. And today, God invites you. You listen to me, because this will sound out in your heart and your mind and your thinking for eternity. God invites you today to receive his life that will be an abundant life, so glorious you won't want any other kind of life. He invites you today to come under his leadership, his mentorship, his lordship, that the Holy Ghost might be able to empower you and teach you everything and establish you in everything that pleases God. It's your choice. People believe somehow that they can have a walk with Christ Jesus and still live in sin and iniquity. No, no. Jesus Christ came for the people who want to be delivered from sin. He did not come for the people who love sin and love unrighteousness. He did not come for them. They will not receive him. Because men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds are evil. But today, if you're done with the wages of sin, there's people in here, you've suffered from sin. It's been disaster and catastrophe, and you are blaming it on everybody else. I'm going to tell you right now, there's only one thing to blame disaster and catastrophe on, it's sin. You walk with God, you're going to be blessed. He's going to take care of you. Hallelujah. People create hell for themselves just because they disobey God. Don't disobey anymore. Begin to obey. Today, Christ Jesus is calling you. Today, the Holy Ghost is calling you. He said, come drink. Come drink of the life. He says to anybody, anyone who wills, I'll give you life. I'll fill you up with this life. I'll come and I'll have my glory overshadow you. You'll be changed. You'll be born again. You'll be made a new creature, new creation, with a heart after God. Is there anybody here today? Anyone here today? Anybody watching by the web? Anybody watching by the YouTube? You want to turn your life over to Jesus? You're done with sin. You're done with the demonic. You're done with bar hopping and carousing and partner hopping. You're done with all the other iniquity, the strife and the envy and all the stuff that does not satisfy. You're done with sin. You're done with hanging out with demon power. Are you ready? Christ Jesus is calling. I don't care how messed up you are, how terrible you've been. I'm telling you, Christ Jesus died to save sinners. The worst of the worst. He died for the worst of the worst. He was numbered with the transgressors. Hung between two thieves to pardon you and me. To pardon us that we might go free. From the bondage, from the sin, to break the chains of iniquity, to open up the prison doors, so that we may step into the glory to behold the one who made us, who chose us, who's called us, who's loved us with an everlasting love. And all you got to do is begin to enjoy this love. I'm going to tell you right now, you won't go back. You won't go back. Today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. Recognize that God demands a change. He demands you to turn from your sin, turn from the way that you've lived, and come follow him. He's not waiting for you to get good enough. He's waiting for you to reach to him, because no man can ever be good enough for him. He comes and invades our life in the midst of our sin and our iniquity and all of our wrongdoing, because we say, I don't want it anymore. I'm done with it. I want to know you. I want to walk with you, Lord. And he comes. And in that state of the heart, with a liberating power, with a mercy and with the grace to take us all the way into everything that is good, wonderful, and holy. Today, is there anyone in this place? You recognize that you're not right with God. You recognize that you're not walking in the Spirit and living by the Spirit, the Holy Ghost. You recognize that there are some real serious issues in your life that you know in your heart. It's not pleasing to God. And you want to change. The power of change is here. Right now, the power of change is here. You come, the power of change is here. Right now. Anybody, you come, power changes here. Christ Jesus stands right here at the threshold of your life to meet you right where you're at, to change you, to take you from who you are, to be everything like who he is. But you're not making heaven, continuing on in the ways of the demonic, to continuing on in the ways, in the fashion of men in this world. Today, right now, Jesus is calling. What will you do with Jesus? Will you say Jesus is a historical figure? Jesus is a religious figure? Jesus is a simile? Jesus is an allegory? He's a thought and a good intention of men's heart. He's a motivation to help people do better. Or will you recognize that he is Almighty God, the only means by which you may be saved? And without him, you are lost and dead in your sin and on a way to an eternity without God. You're going to have to decide, because I know what the Holy Ghost is doing right now. The Holy Ghost is calling all men to repentance. The grace of God has appeared to every single person, teaching them to deny ungodliness and worldly lusts, and to come on over here into this wonderful righteousness. Come on over here into this wonderful goodness. I'm going to plead with you just a little bit more, because I know the Spirit of the Lord has been pleading with some that are here and some that are watching on the web and watching on the YouTube. You might be saying, well, I'm watching this many days later, many weeks later. Listen, Father's got it all put together. You're standing in front of that TV right now. You're sitting in front of the computer right now, because God has given you an opportunity to hear His voice. Harden not your heart. Respond to Him. You may not have another chance like this. You're not going to be singing Kiss the Devil in one way or the other. You're not going to be dancing to the world's music, moving to the world's demands, and find yourself in heaven when you lay down and breathe out your last breath. Father's not willing that any perish, but that everyone come to this glorious work of salvation. What will you do? What will you do? What will you do? Will you call upon the name of the Lord Jesus so that He can come, so heaven can invade your life? Or will you continue on living as you've been living? Father, we thank You for Your mercy. We thank You that You invade our lives with Your compelling love. We thank You, Father God, that in Your mercy, You continue to deal with our hearts to bring us to a place where we can find ourselves moving with You into an eternity that is so wonderful. Finding our lives headed every day to a wonderful place, a destination that goes beyond anything that any man ever imagined. Father, we pray that every eye will see and every ear will hear. Father, we pray in Jesus' name that the people of Southern California and of this nation will begin to shake like leaves in the midst of a windstorm under Your presence. Once again, that what You did in the days gone by in the 1600s and the revival of the 1700s and the moving of Your Spirit in the mid-1800s in this nation, God, it will be greater than ever before, and that there will be a people from whom You may move. That You'll find those people here in this place here. Father, would You take a hold of Bill and Jonathan's life here today? As they begin to deal with the things and the areas of their life that have not been committed and consecrated to You as it should be. Where they've listened to the voice of another. Father, I pray right now in the name of Jesus. In Your mercy and Your grace, that You strengthen them, give them the divine ability, Father, to cut things off. Remove it out of the way. You have to remove it out of the way. In revivals that we read about in the book of Acts, they took the things that were contrary to God in their life and they came and they burned them. You just begin to move things out of the way. You can't have it positioned in your life, because what will happen is Satan will wait in the moment of weakness, in the moment where you've just been beaten down by things and discouraged by things, and he'll try to put it upon you and just draw you into his to the sin and iniquity, and then lay upon you great condemnation and hold you into the prison of it. Now in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray you go just receive wisdom in your spirit. Cut things off. Cut it off. Go to it and cut it off. Cut it off. Don't pass by there anymore. Don't go down that street no more. Don't walk in behind that door anymore. Cut it off from you. Because it doesn't take long, and the Lord sees you standing against the sin and the iniquity of which Satan has come to destroy you. He's brought his net to hunt you that he may take your life from you. God sees you standing against it and not being willing to participate in it anymore. And God brings it down and says, no more to Satan. Everybody probably in this place to some degree, or most people in this place to some degree, you remember where you had problems in your life and things that were going on that you knew weren't right with God, and it just seemed like you could never get over them. But Father gave you the strength because you were willing. You stood up against it, and then it wasn't even a temptation anymore, because God said, enough. It's done. It's cut off from you. Why? Because you stood with your own will and your own heart, your own willingness, and you said, no, I want to walk with You, God. I know that I'm weak, but Father, I want You to strengthen me. I want to walk with You. And He gave you the strength to say no. It didn't take too many times to say no, and Father stared at you and said, He said no. Amen. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. so fall in love with the glory of heaven, so fall in love with His mercy, so fall in love with His grace, that if you do slip in a slippery place, you get right back up. God will give you hinds feet. Papa will give you hinds feet. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, your foul spirit of hell messing with the property of God, I bind you now in Jesus' name. I know how I feel about Satan messing with people. My, I can only just imagine how Jesus feels about it. The captain of our salvation, who comes to our defense, if just there's a little bit of willingness. There's a little bit of willingness. He doesn't come with condemnation. He doesn't come saying, "Ah, man, I thought better of you." He comes, "Come to me." He comes with a zeal and a passion to break off every yoke, to not allow another day of sin and iniquity to be able to reign in your life. What an amazing Savior. He's the deliverer who wants to save you now. In every situation you find yourself in where the enemy tries to come destroy you, Christ Jesus comes to rescue you. He's your rescuer. Hallelujah. Come on now, you listen to me. You listen to me. If you want to participate with the Holy Ghost, begin to encourage people. Begin to show them that they can stand. Huh? God, the Holy Ghost don't remember anything of the past that's been halakotaparanaya, erased, abolished by the blood of the Lamb. On the kaya. Nothing of, there is no memory. Halapaya. You get to Mosatia. Stand before the Lord Jesus Christ right now. The Retena, the Father, the King of Glory, as one who never sinned, who never did anything wrong. Because there is no memory of it in His presence, because Satan's not allowed. There are many people who are accusers. There are many people who operate with the satanic and they're always bringing up what was in the past, what happened at some former day and time. I can tell you right now, you don't want to participate with that thing. Oh, you want to get in right there where the Holy Ghost is talking, where Jesus is talking. As He declares to us how holy and acceptable we are. How all the things of the past are gone, erased to be remembered no more. How He's there to be our strength, to take us to that place where we, without reproof, blameless before the Father. Spotless. You know, men would always try to hold something a little bit more over someone else, but not Christ Jesus. He brings us completely into everything that He is and calls us as spotless as He is. As He's the cornerstone, we're a living stone. Hallelujah. As He is the Lamb of God, we're the sheep of the Lord. I mean, come on. I mean, the pure and perfect identity with Him. Hallelujah. Joined unto Him. One spirit with the Lord. Religion will always make you inferior. Religion will always subjugate you. Religion will always make you not good, quite good enough. You're almost there. Not this relationship. Not heaven. Not what Jesus did at Calvary. He says, come on in. You come. Ha. Religion will make you earn it. Christ Jesus will give it to you. Come on. God the Holy Ghost will be your surety of it. Hallelujah. Mandeya Sheparai. Say change. Say conformity. I'm conforming.
I'm conforming.
I'm gonna do what Jesus did.
I'm gonna do what
Jesus. I'm gonna look around the house.
I'm gonna look around the house.
See if there's anything.
See if there's anything
that doesn't belong in heaven.
That doesn't belong in heaven.
And I'm gonna kick it out.
And I'm gonna kick it out.
Amen.
Amen.
That's what you're gonna
yes,
do.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name. Right now, in Jesus' name, I give you my peace. In Jesus' name. I give you my peace. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
I give you my encouragement. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, I give you my help. In Jesus' name, I give you my full assistance, says the Holy Ghost. Woo! Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Well, praise the name of the Lord. If you're not happy, God wants you to be. The Holy Spirit is here to supply happy. Just participate with the Lord, you get happier still. Amen. The more you participate with them, the happier you get. The more you move with them, woo, the more blessed you find yourself to be. Come worship the Lord with your tithes, with your offerings. Just bless the Lord with all that is within you. Honor Him with your substance and with the first fruits of your increase. So shall your barns be filled, and your vats will overflow with all kinds of new wine and blessings in Jesus' name. Find a bunch of people around you that you don't know, not the person you live with, and hug them and bless them and tell them that you're just so happy that they're here. Hallelujah. And if anybody wants prayer for anything at all, we're here to pray with you and for you. I know the power of God will touch you. That's good. Amen. Hallelujah. That's fine. Hallelujah. That's all right. That's all right. That's all right. Listen, if all you got is a penny, it's something, you know. Come on. Praise God. You just throw that in. You just believe God that you're going to be able to give more. Hallelujah. Shito Ramo Shekaya. Shito Ramo Shekaya. Shito Ramakaya Shaya Potanaya. Hallelujah. Blessed is the name of the Lord from this day forward and forevermore. Sukana manjeya perenishi. Sukana manjesuta romo sutaya. Madarara manjesitiya namahate. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Great movings of the Spirit in your life. Great giftings of God revealed through your life. Great power and demonstration of the Holy Ghost in the midst of you as Christ Jesus is revealed.